thesis as the fact that she went crazy, and that seems well apropos. My professor just tosses back his head, and a dry Manhattan. I'm thinking which will kill him quicker, the Big Apple or the liquor, when suddenly I panic and I tell myself I must get someplace cold. I up and run toward Penn Station like I swear my head was ready to blow, and I hop a train to Jersey just as fast as any person can go. The 90 minutes out, I get off at some provincial hamlet I've never heard of. There's a real estate office right on the block. I can't afford a two-bedroom. I go into shock. I think, what the heck? I write a check. 'Cause there's sunlight and closets and laundry. But mostly, it's calm, calm. Times Square at 5 a.m. calm, like totally freak me out calm, like I'm gonna slowly go crazy and throw myself over the balcony calm. Damn it. So, I tear up my deposit and I head back to Penn Station. Of course, the subway's broken, so I walk 4 miles home. And like 14 hours later, I get back to my apartment with my crazy spastic roommates and a room, well, of my own. I've got this black and white poster on my wall. That says, my Manhattan. So I give it the finger. But I let my gaze linger. And I notice how the people look like tiny specks of gray, all haphazardly arranged, just like they were in that Monet. And suddenly I'm struck by this bizarro revelation that, like Warren's whacked out theory, might deserve some exploration. I sit on my bed and I realize I'm finally calm.
Everyone's got a big picture that guides them through life towards what they want to be. So if everyone's got a big picture, how come my picture's something that I still have yet to see? This is a flyer that's been in my backpack for weeks now. Buried down deep, getting faded and wrinkled and torn. I have been making these flyers till kingdom come. Writing all of these words that now seem kinda dumb. And it's hard not to feel that this isn't my real life story. I imagine that I'd come here and do something big, that the artist in me would prevail. But all I've done so far is copy these words from some hippie downtown who's sitting in jail. Well, this is a guy who cannot be described as a quitter. This is a guy who should do what he set out to do. You might snicker and laugh that it's so cliché to think making these means I've got something to say. But I do, and that's why I wish they could be my life story. My life story. My life. Duh.
Taxi! 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 Thank you. Hi. I'm not usually inclined to take up useless conversation with a taxi driver. As I was walking, all these taxis without passengers in constant circulation, without a destination, and that's not what life should be about. So we're gonna get out, hit the gas, make a turn, let this taxi speed, cause there isn't a thing in this world that I need more than some place my aim and head any clear, probably miles and miles from here. Trust me, I'm not crazy, I can see you making faces in the rearview mirror. I will pay you what the meter says to drive me up the highway. I don't care how far the way is. I guess what I'm trying to say is, in the bike lane of life, sometimes you gotta get out. What? No. No, no, no. Weren't you listening? I don't know where to. You're the professional. You should be making these kinds of decisions. Oh. Look, I am really not a person who is qualified to tell you where we should be going. I mean, I just let my boyfriend standing back there on the sidewalk, which is bad enough without disclosing. He was actually proposing. And that's it, there isn't any doubt that we've gotta get across the bridge if the gas makes taxi speed. Cause there isn't a thing in this world that I need more than some place my head can be clear. Probably miles and miles from here. I don't mean to freak and I don't mean to shout, but right now, God, I've really gotta get out. I can't stay here anymore, I've just gotta get out. Though I still don't really know what I am getting out for. I should be with him and Christ feel happy, but it's like something's changed inside of my DNA. I just want to tell him that I'm lost and that I'm frightened, but something's there that smothers all the words I want to say. So how can I be what makes him happy when I can't even make a promise that I will stay? I've gotten used to keeping all the space between us. And when he looks right at me, I've just got to run away.
Trust fund.
Trust Fund.
There you go.
Thanks for giving me back my notes. Don't think I ever said that to you.
You didn't. But it's okay. What are they for, anyway?
Just my graduate dissertation. It sounds more impressive than it is. In fact, it sucks. At least that's what my professor told me at our meeting the other day.
If you come up here every day, and you look out at the buildings, you start to notice how the view's always changing. Your curtains on the windows right there, fifth floor. That flower pot that was not there before. So I come up here every day, and I watch the landscape shifting. A coat of paint, a bar that's changed its name. Nothing ever stays the same.
When I was just a little girl, I'd look out my bedroom window and see the skinny little tree out in the garden. And season after season, it grew and grew. And I surmised, though toddler-sized, that I would too. And now here I am with you. Overlook that city, and I think I'm still that girl, staring out her window, seeing things much bigger than she is, and I know that I'll never grow as tall as these buildings. I'll never quite reach the sky, but God, Warren, I want to try. Don't ask me why. Warren, tell me about your big picture, how you came to New York to begin it. I mean, somehow you found this big picture.
But the trouble is finding the right way to paint myself in it.
What do you mean? I thought we were all just little specks huddled together.
I mean, look at me here. With my bag full of pages, pages like these. These backpacks of pages, mountains of pages that nobody sees.
What are you talking about?
I come here every day and see the world evolving from the curtains on the windows to the sky. But I stay just the same, and no one ever sees me because I...
I decided it was time. Got my stuff from her apartment. All the clothes, I just moved in there. Bunch of books, the tie she made me wear. Did her dishes, left my key. It had been days and where was she?
I couldn't call or even show. I thought it would be best to let him go. I was stopping at the corner, feeling tense and all shook up. And for no good reason, I look up.
I see a piece of paper falling from the sky. It makes me stop because it's falling from so high. Dancing on the wind all on its own.
Sort of a project, but no one ever took them.
Warren, look.
Is that one of mine?
You gave it to me before I knew you.
You took it?
I kept it in my bag. Never let tall buildings block the view of your dreams.
That's mine.
It's a little precious, but it spoke to me.
Keep it. The rest are going over the edge.
Wait. Throw these, too.
Your notes? But what about your thesis?
It's all wrong.
Maybe if we work...
No, it's wrong. This whole thing is wrong. I don't even like Virginia Woolf. Her life is depressing. This isn't right. It's not me. It's not my...
My story?
Yes.
Dozens of people reach for the pages that ring.
Look how many people are coming over.
Dozens more looking skyward to see them explained. A small piece of paper comes floating my way. It says, "Don't worry, everything will be okay."
Okay.
Okay.
Ready?
You bet.
On your mark.
On your mark, and set
the
course.
Square and through everything.
Warren, it's beautiful.
My cell phone rings.
I know.
It's Claire.
Look.
Claire.
We met, of all places, in front of Gristiti some freakishly cold winter's day. I had on several unflattering layers of wool. He slipped on the ice with his grocery bags full. So I rescued some Fruit Loops that dropped on the curb. And he made a remark that my smile was superb. And I thought it was sweet, and I started to go when he said, "Hey, what you doing tomorrow?" Because I'll be here on the corner of Bleecker and Mercer's tomorrow at 7. If you want to meet up, I'll be waiting right here. And in case there are two fellers waiting for you, my name's John. He waved, and then he was gone. Needless to say, I went back there to meet him, but mostly to see if he'd show. And there he was, out in the cold with his jacket pulled tight. He took me to dinner and kissed me goodnight. And the next week we went to this terrible play. And the week after that, drank hot chocolate all day. And when suddenly 8 or 9 months had gone by, when he said, "Hey, what you doing the rest of your life?" Because I'll be here for as long as however you want me to be, there's no question. There is nothing I've wanted so much in my life. This might sound immature, but I'm totally sure you're the one. And we had just begun. We got hitched in September, a favorite month, with a rock band that played in this old synagogue. And we bought an apartment on West 17th Street and talked about children and getting a dog. Our first anniversary came in a flash, and we promised to take the day off. He had to stop into his office that morning, and so I went walking uptown to this bakery I know. When I heard on the street what I thought was a joke, till I noticed the sirens and saw all the smoke. So I'm running back home with this feeling of dread to the voicemail he left with the last words he said. I'm sorry. I don't mean to ruin your evening by bringing up all of this stuff. You're probably wondering why I even called you tonight. Well, today something happened that spooked me all right. I saw this storm cloud of papers come down from the sky. And I thought of that day, and I started to cry. Oh, and as sure as I breathe, I heard John clear as day saying, hey, you're allowed to move on. It's okay. Because I'll be here, even if you decide to get rid of my favorite sweater. If you even go out on my birthday this year, instead of sitting at home letting all of life's moments pass by, you don't have to cry, because I'll be here when you start going back to the places we went to together. When you take off my ring and you let yourself smile, when you meet someone patient and handsome and true, and he says that he wants to be married to you, and you call him up and he meets you downtown, and you finally answer him yes. Yes, Jason, I will marry you. I will give you my heart. It has taken so long, but I'm ready to start. Right now, John is whispering congrats in my ear, 'cause I finally let myself tell you that I will be
your favorite painting is this piece of...
Hey, what's wrong with it?
Well, it's a little bit boring.
Then you must be ignoring the most important bit.
I don't see it. Lauren, we've been walking around passing statues of angels and portraits of kings.
So?
So, you could choose anyone, and we're standing in front of this painting of everyday things.
It's beautiful, right?
No, it isn't. It's plain.
Well, part of our trip to the Met is I get to explain.
Here we go.
So, this is a painting of what?
It's a painting of apples.
That's right, that's right. So the artist has us looking at what?
Boring everyday things.
Well, yes.
And the point?
The point is that things aren't beautiful on their own. Beautiful comes from reflection. Beautiful takes a person who makes a connection. You know what I mean? For beautiful to happen, the beautiful has got to be seen.
Okay. I like that shade of red right there. The spot where the apple is peeling. It's deep as an ocean, but lighter than air.
It's simple, familiar, and full of feeling.
The color of Saturdays here at the Met.
The color of shouting from rooftops.
You bet.
The color of knowing that life is okay.
The color of...